First of all then, Mick, thanks a lot for taking up some of your time to do this interview for us.
Well, no problem. We've been trying to do it for a long time. I know you've asked me so many times and I've not made excuses, but just found it hard to get around to. But let's hope we get it together this time.
Okay, well, we all know you as the famous violinist in the Electric Light Orchestra, but just to start us off, tell us a little bit about your life before you joined ELO. Like, you know, where were you born? Where did you grow up and go to school and that, and a little bit about your family?
I was born in Harrogate, up in Yorkshire. Went to school in Harrogate and Knaresbury, which is where I actually lived, which is a little town down the road from Harrogate, and it's where the famous Mother Shipton came from and prophesied what would happen in the world, and most of the things have so far have come true. And she said, when the railway bridge at Knaresbury falls down, the world will end.
Right.
I've always kept a close eye on that one when I was a kid up there. family-wise, gosh, I don't know. I lived a lot of the time with my granny and mum and sister in Knaresborough, and a brief trip down to Wales and where my dad was working in Porth Call. Brought up, as I say, most of the time in Knaresborough, spoke Harrogate. I'm trying to think. It's not very exciting stuff, really, but it's where I first started to play the violin, and because my granny was a music teacher, and a friend of hers sent a violin home with her one day, and I started to play it like a banjo to start with, and then eventually started to have lessons, and just went from there, really.
Okay, so was music a big thing in the Kaminski household?
It was, because I was saying my granny was a piano and vocal teacher, with some young kids learning piano to some quite seasoned singers who used to sing in WI choir she used to run, and it was quite a diverse range, really.
Okay, so you're obviously very interested in music as a child. Did you always hope that one day you'd be able to make a living out of it?
I think, as I said before, it was always a dream, but I mean, the track record of being able to make a living out of music is a rocky road. And in the early days, I was obviously looking to go into the orchestral side. And I don't know, I mean, things were a lot easier in those days because there were a lot more orchestras and a lot more opportunities. I mean, nowadays, I can't imagine how you come out of college and try and find an orchestra, because there's so, you know, there have been so few of them now. It must be a really difficult road to go down.
I've always assumed that for somebody to play the violin must be interested in classical music. Did you listen to much of it, and do you play it yourself?
I was classically trained to start with, and went to college, obviously, on the classical road. And I played, obviously, from when I was five up until, I still play classical music now, but nothing like I used to, because the rock and roll sort of bug got into my bloodstream, and I sort of tended to veer off into the more, you know, pop rock, whatever you want to call it, inside.
Okay, so what about a favourite classical composer then? You got any favourites?
I haven't really, no. I mean, I listen to all sorts, but it's not, there's nobody I could always say leaps out, and that's the one for me, because I think, and they all had their good bits, and it didn't appeal to me, so I don't just have a very mixed bag.
And what about the pop music then? Are you similar to everyone of our sort of age, you were brought up on the Beatles and the Stones, or was it something a bit different to that?
Beatles and Stones, obviously. I was a bit before that, when people like Donny Donegan were about. That was one of the first sort of popular music ideas. I had a little banjo ukulele thing, and I used to hang down your head. Tom Dooley is one of the first tunes. My mum used to put a chalk mark where you had to stop when you got to the right note for the high beat. So, and then it went from Beatles, Stones. I used to be a big fan of Alan Price, you know, the Animals. I don't know, it was very varied.
Yeah. You got any favourites at the moment, like, you know, the latest artists?
These music I don't listen to a lot of anymore, I must be quite honest. I can't remember the last time I put a CD on and sat down to listen to it.
No, times have changed, haven't they? You can't, you know, I used to always be able to name what was at number one, but these days...
I wouldn't even have a clue. I look at the charts and I think it's come from another planet or something. I don't know hardly anybody on there anymore.
Let's tell us about your early bands then. I mean, I know of things like Cow and Joe Soap, Grand Stampede and a few others. Which was the first one?
Well, right back at the very beginning, there was a band at school which is called Acceleration, which is when I was playing electric organ. And then, where did we go from there, I suppose? Yeah, then college, the next sort of real band was at college, and that was a band called One by One, A Cow Went By, which quickly got shortened down to Cow, and that was kind of jazzy influence, because the reason, that's when I first started to play electric violin, because when I went to college on the classical side, there was a jazz course running in the same place, you know, alongside the classical course, and I started to mix with some of the jazz side, and they said, well, have you ever thought of playing electric violin? And I got an old beaten up violin and put a pickup on it, and after experimenting in several different ways, managed to get some sort of decent sound out of it, and that's when we formed that band, and it all sort of went away from classical stuff from there.
Did you record any albums with any of these bands?
Not Cow, no. There was one album with Andy Roberts and one album with Joe Soap. But the Cow, we never actually got down recording. Although, having said that, when Violinski came out, eventually, a lot of the people that had been involved in Cow were actually in Violinski. So some of the stuff we released with Violinski, we used to play as Cow in the early days.
Okay, and is it true that you saw the job for ELO in Melody Maker? Is that true?
It is, yes. No word of a lie there.
And did you have to go and audition, and were there other violinists auditioning at the time?
There was a lot of people applied, apparently. It was, and it took me a bit of a while to actually be convinced to go for it, because, as I say, I was kind of very much on the jazz side at that time, and I'd only heard Rella Beethoven, and I thought, well, that doesn't sound much like jazz to me, so it took a bit of nudging before I actually applied. But I later found out that Mike Edwards, who we sadly lost recently, saw the list of applicants, and he saw my name and who I was playing with, which was Joe Soap at that time, and he actually found we'd be doing a gig somewhere and came down to have a listen, and came and met me afterwards and said, I see you coming to have a go for the job with ELO. And he said, well, why don't you learn some ELO, from the ELO songs, which I hadn't heard, apart from Beethoven. So he actually lent me an album. I learned some of the tracks, and when I went to the audition, it was kind of a good starting point, because when they wanted to play some of their stuff, I could actually join in straight away.
All right, I was going to ask you if you had to actually play a particular piece of music, or...
Yeah, I turned up there as soon as I got there, and I used to use a wah-wah pedal in the Joe Soap days and the Cow days. I turned up there and walked into the audition and set it up so I could actually play through an amp and everything. And they said, okay, we'll just play something. So I went into one of my kind of jazzy improvisations featuring wah-wah and all sorts of weird stuff, and... I don't know, it must have gone down okay, because, as I say, even Don Arden was around at my first audition, and I think most of the band were. I can't remember if everybody was, and we just went on from there.
And did they tell you straight away, or did you have to go home and they sort of...
It was quite a long job, because, as I say, they had a lot of people to hear, and yeah. I think I did, was it two or three? We moved up to the Midlands for the second or third interview, and I think it was at the Boggery where we all the gear was set up, and there again we were still, I think it was down to between probably two and three of us towards the end, and it eventually I got the call from Bev, and he says, well, the job's yours if you want it. I didn't complain, and the rest just, you know, went from there.
Yeah. So do you remember, did you go straight into the recording studio to work on an album, or were they about to go on tour? Can you remember?
Yes, we went into the recording studio. We were on the third day, which half had been recorded. It'd not be on the third day, the actual sort of mini suite that Jeff had written. So we started recording there, and at the time, it was only Mike Edwards on cello, because I'd forgotten that Colin Walker had just left, and Huey hadn't joined by then. So we spent many days in the studio, me and Mike, and Jeff directing us, and all the string parts on the On the Third Day bit are just me and Mike.
And I think Wilf is still on some of the other tracks as well, isn't he?
He's on the other side, yes. As I said, that had been recorded before I joined, so he was kind of mid-album when I jumped in.
Is there one track that you remember that you, like your first track you recorded?
Not really. The same, because that On the Third Day suite's quite it's all joined up, and it just sort of wandered from one track to the next. And I played on Hall of the Mountain King as well, but I can't remember what order we did them in. It was a while ago.